The following message by Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark is brought to you by Full Stature Ministries and its supporters. For more information about Full Stature Ministries, please visit forgive123.com. That's forgive123.com.
Good morning. I've been this last couple of weeks into a particular book that I'm really enjoying, and I got some really good revelation out of it, and I really wanted to share it with you guys. I see there's a lot of visitors here today, but for the most part, the people that come to this church know that our ministry, Kingdom Life Church, is teaching. Full Stature Ministries, which is the offshoot of the church and team. We're all together. Basically, our underlining theme is lordship and how to make Jesus Lord of your life in every area. So that's like when it's like taking all of your different loves and your different things that you enjoy doing and making sure that the Lord is supreme authority over those things as well. It's not that I love Jesus, I love golf, I love my children. It's not all the same, but it's making sure that he's Lord over all of those things. And when we have an issue that comes up, he's Lord over those emotions. And that's what we teach here. It's basically just lordship. Some of the stuff I was reading this week, it got me so excited. I want to draw. Now I really am an artist. You might not see that in this, but just say that these are trees. I say that they are trees, so they're trees. And the reason I made two trees here is that if anybody could kind of get the hieroglyphs. We're going to be talking a little bit about the trees in the garden and before the fall of man. And I know everybody, especially people that were schooled in the faith, the story is very common even with children, Adam and Eve and the serpent and everything. But my focus is going to be on the two trees that were in the garden. The one was the tree of knowledge of good and evil. We could say this is the good side, this is the evil side. The other was the tree of life, which represented the wisdom and life that God would want us to lead through Christ now. Before I get into that, though, I wanted to basically just hit on one thing is, you know, even in sales and in marketing, if anybody's ever taken anything, we know that every single sense that we have, if you're trying to sell a product, it has to affect one of those senses and make them better, or make, you know, it has to be desirable. It has to, you know, look good, smell good, taste good, feel good in order to sell a product, correct? It's almost common sense. Nobody wants to buy anything that's bad. Nobody wants to buy something that's you know, you don't want to go to the store and get some rotten apples. I mean, what the heck? So it's kind of common sense. However, I think there's been a twist, and it's a very now word as far as what we see good as and what we see bad as. And there's a possibility. I want to put it out there. There's a possibility of where things are leading, especially with the Supreme Court rulings that were just in the last month or two. Just different things, they're calling evil good and good evil. the road, the ditch, the road. And that was prophesied that that would happen in the last days. But the thing is they're calling that, the way that they justify it is it's a good thing. It's good. It's good to be nice to people. We have so many TV shows that were out there over the last, I don't know how many years, but they had like the home improvement stuff and where they build a house for the person that really needs it. And then they, you know, it's all elaborate and it stirs up your emotion that the goodness of people is, it's so good. And there's so many different things in the media that actually pump good up. But my thing is here that I want to try to explain is what the difference is between just being humanitarian or actually following in what God wants you to do with your life. Let's see. There was... let's see, Mark 10. I have it marked in my Bible. Let's look at Mark 10, verse 17 and 18. This is where Jesus counsels the rich young ruler. And I don't know if a lot of you probably have read this story before, but it starts out. Now, he was going out on the road one, and then one came running and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" Now, you have to understand this guy came running out of nowhere. This fellow was very wealthy. He came from a really good background. And as if you read further after that verse, Jesus explains to him, I don't want to read the first part yet, but the second part, did you basically is like, I followed all your commandments. I've done everything since I was young. I've kept myself pure and all of these things. But right before that, I want you to see what Jesus said before he even answered him. He said, "Why do you call me good? No one but God is good," is basically what Jesus told him. And that confused me at first. I was like, what the heck? Well, wasn't Jesus good? Yeah. But what he was trying to do for that fellow was basically tell him that his idea or his concept of good wasn't on the level. And the only one person that is good is God. And everything, every good gift comes from him. And outside of him, you don't have anything good. And it's funny because you know how we respond? He responded by something that he already saw in that man that he needed. He said that you lack one thing. And then he said, take up all your stuff and sell it and follow me. And because he was so wealthy and you know, he was sad and he went away. Later in the verse, you see that he actually explains to his disciples that, you know, if you're going to actually get 100-fold back everything that you gave up for me for following me. And then I'm thinking, why didn't he tell that guy that he would get 100 more times the stuff that he was ready to give up, you know, to follow Christ? But it was a heart condition, and he was skewed in the way that he saw what good really was. So not only was that man a really good person, he did, you know, he probably gave to the poor and needy. He probably he never talked back to his parents, and he was very wealthy and good with business, and he kept all the commandments. But he wasn't willing to give it up. And basically what that means, just like what we teach here, is he wasn't ready to make Jesus Lord over his stuff. And so that's what Jesus saw, and that's why he went away sad. He missed out. In In some of Paul's writings, I believe in 2 Corinthians in chapter 11, he makes a statement that made me do some of the study on this, made it more, you know, complete. He says, "I fear somehow your pure and undivided devotion to Christ will be corrupted, just as Eve was deceived by the cunning ways of the serpent." Now, Paul was writing to the Corinthians. These were people that already knew Christ. So I want to, you know, it's not just for people that don't, that are unsaved, that can be deceived. This is actually people that were in the Word, that know the Lord. He was writing, "Please, I'm afraid that you could be deceived. Let's teach you how not to be deceived." And his main statement here that lit up was Eve was deceived by the cunning ways of the serpent. So I want to see how Eve was deceived. I mean, you look back and you say they were in a perfect place, a perfect condition. They walked with the Lord and they were with him in the garden. How did she manage to get deceived? Because we're not even close to that. We're in a fallen state. We're in a fallen world. How much easier is it for the enemy to get us in a deception, right? So I looked at these, and I was like, well, how did she get deceived? So let's go back to Genesis 3. Because I don't want to be deceived. And the thing is the horrible thing about deception is we don't even know that we are when we are in it. We think that we are right. And that's what's really scary about it. But in order to get the standard of what is right and wrong, we need to understand what happened in the garden first. I'm looking at Genesis 2, starting with verse 15. "God took man and set him down in the Garden of Eden to work the ground and keep it in order. God commanded the man, 'You can eat from any tree in the garden except from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Don't eat from it. The moment you eat from it, that tree, you're dead.'" And then it goes on, and Eve was created. Now, specifically, the verse that I wanted you guys to look at is, "God commanded man, 'You can eat from any tree in the garden.'" That shows, I mean, how many thousands of trees were in that garden, right? His goodness. It shows his goodness, his favor. You're allowed to eat from any one of these trees in the garden, thousands of trees, except for this one, right? And he was good with that. He needed a companion, so he made him Eve right after. So I wanted to see, you know, well, where Eve came in was after the commandment was given to Adam not to eat. So she really didn't hear this firsthand. And you know how many times people come, you know, people get together and different things are spoken and some things are just a little bit off by the time they're done being spoken. You know, we could start with my dad here on this side of the room and say one sentence and share it, you know, in everybody's ear till we get to the last person over there, and it'll be slightly different, you know. There's teachings, you could hear people that say, it's just like for the love of money is the root of all evil. And you could go home, and if it's not a reality in your life, and you could repeat it to your friends, money's the root of all evil. And it's just slightly wrong. It's very wrong. It's the love of money that is the root of all evil. Well, so I'm just saying that Eve wasn't on the picture in the picture yet when that commandment was given to Adam, and I think that possibly might have been the open door that the enemy used. There's probably a lot of different theories and theological aspects of that. But when you look at in chapter 3, it says, "Now the serpent was more cunning than any beast of the field which the Lord had made. And he said to the woman," because I guess it was normal that animals spoke back then. I don't know. But she wasn't real shocked. "Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree in the garden?" And her response was, "We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, all of them, but of the fruit that is in the midst of the garden. But God said, you shall not eat it, nor shall you touch it, lest you die." And that was her response to Satan. Now, this is the thing. It wasn't an exact interpretation of what, it wasn't exact knowledge of what God gave Adam. He didn't tell Adam that you can't touch it. There's that, just that little change. In any scripture, in any translation that I read in, there's nothing that says don't eat and don't touch to Adam. So that little twinge of twisted knowledge, it's basically the difference. It's difference between revelation and given knowledge, like transferred knowledge. Like if I'm teaching you something, and you're writing it down in your book, it's just transferred knowledge for me. And then there's a difference between revelation, which is directly from God, is what Adam got. So what happens here, we'll read on. "So when the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was pleasant to the eyes and the tree was desirable to make one wise, she took of its fruit and she also gave it to her husband and he ate. And the eyes of both of them were opened and they knew that they were naked and they covered themselves." Okay. The four things that you could see in the scripture that Satan did in order to deceive Eve. One, the first question when you look at it will take the eye off of everything that God gave you, all of his goodness. Just a second to look at something that wasn't yours. You've changed your focus. And you know what happens when you change your focus, whatever you pay attention to, you give power to, right? That's the first thing. The second thing, what happened? He completely negated the word of God. He said, no, God didn't say that you would die. You won't die. The third thing, not only won't you die, but he's withholding something from you. He's withholding something good from you. And lastly, the enemy, what he does is he offers that good thing that is being withheld. Let's look at the first one. The first one is he took her eyes off of all the goodness of God to look at that one thing that she can't have. He said to the woman, "Has God indeed said, you shall not eat of every tree in the garden?" Just to get her mind off of all the other trees. Oh yeah, there is one that we can't eat from. That was his strategy. His objective to sway Eve from godly wisdom. He cleverly crafted a question that enticed the woman to momentarily lose sight of the myriad available fruit trees that were in the garden and just to that one. And of course, after you focus on that one, you end up wanting it, wondering what's going on. Why is God taking this from me? Or keeping. The thing is it's no different today, the tactic of the enemy. None of these four things are different today. They're the same. He works the same way. So this is why I wanted to really share this with you, because it's revelation to me, and I wanted to be able to get it out. the thing was, is when she knew the truth and she responded, we may eat of the tree of the fruit of, you know, through the, but the fruit in the tree in the midst of the garden, but God said, you shall not nor touch it, lest you die. And that's why I thought it was interesting, because the inaccuracy of her reply made me believe that that's a possibility of where Satan kind of got in. See, what we need is revelation. Nobody can refute the revelation that you get between yourself and God when it's real and it's life-giving and it's supported by the Word of God. You have something that nobody can refute. It's the difference between revealed knowledge and communicated knowledge. There was one scripture in Matthew 16 where Jesus and the disciples were together, and he questioned them and said, who do men say that I am? And some of them said that you're the prophet Elijah, you're John the Baptist, you're, you know, all these different things that they came up with. But what was really interesting is when he asked the question, but who do you say that I am? See, there's a difference between getting all of your teaching and wisdom off of Facebook and, you know, and on all these little cute little sayings that people have on Instagram and whatnot. But is it revelation to you? Is it between you and God? Is there a relationship there, you know, that produces fruit in your life? But who do you say that I am? And the disciples stood paralyzed with no response. Had Jesus not asked the first question, they likely would have been influenced by others, right? By what they read, by what they heard. But he made their eyes go back to, you know, you're with me now. Who am I? And what's really cool about it is Peter. He was the only one that answered. He blurted out, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And what's really great about that is that's where Jesus says that that's where I'm going to build my church. I'm going to call you Peter, you know, for that is the rock, and I'm going to build my church upon this rock. Now that rock that he's talking about is revelation, the revelation of who he was. Right? That's the foundation. So he's not going to build the church on communicated knowledge. We can be puffed up with communicated knowledge, but it's not a church. The second thing I wanted to look at was that he negated the word of God altogether. This step would be a direct contradiction to what God had already stated. However, it would be clearly wrapped in what seemed to be sound reasoning. Listen, it sounded good, reasonable. And not only that, there is a profit and a benefit too. The serpent said to the woman, "You will not surely die. For God knows that in that day you eat, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." You will not surely die. It's an exact contradiction to the scriptures. The third area. Now, mind you, this is not just the story of the trees. This is what's happening and can happen in our own lives in a lot of different areas. The enemy is not changed. God is withholding something good from you. Consider the serpent's words, "For God knows." They imply something is being withheld. For God knows something that you don't. And not just anything, but something that would make Adam and Eve's life better. Something that would make them take them to a higher level. Since there was good in the tree, He carefully basically put his words together to make them sound logical. It tickles the brain. Sounds great. And lastly, the enemy offers that good thing that's being withheld. Eve saw that the tree was good and pleasant and would make her wise. All these were desirable and beneficial traits. As Eve was staring at the tree, her thoughts began to go down a new road. There's something good and beneficial in that tree, but wait a minute, God's forbidden it. My husband and I could have a better life. We could be wiser and happier, and it's being withheld. I thought our Creator was loving and gracious, but in reality, he's deceptive. He's hiding something good from us. Does it not sound almost familiar with some of the things that are being said out there now? I thought God was good. He's you know, the scripture's wrong. He's deceptive. I have so many notes here. There's so much that I read that I actually got stuck. I could probably write in my own book. The two trees basically represent ways, right? This is the way of life, and this is the way of death, okay? And way here is basically means wisdom, okay? If you say this is the way of life, this is the way of God's wisdom, which is first pure, then peaceable. It's life. And that's the way that he wants us to take. That's where we get our life and more abundant. The way of death, you see, it's mixed. It has the side of the tree that was evil and the side of the tree that was good. But if you notice, Eve was not attracted to this side. The Christians are not attracted. The people that are going to church and that have Christ as their Savior, they don't purposely go out and do satanic rituals and go to wild parties and they are more attracted to good things. Generally, people. But the way that Satan got Eve was the fact that this side, the three different things that were said, it was good for food. It was pleasant to look at. And it was beneficial to make her wise. She was only attracted to the good side of that tree. That's all that she was paying attention to. She didn't really care about the other side. And probably, if it was the serpent was probably standing right in front. Let's go to the other side and look. Isn't that scary? This represents the wisdom of man. And this represents the wisdom of God. Now, we have this restored through Christ if we take it and we make him Lord. This we have when we're born. We basically know right from wrong on a very basic level, and throughout life, it gets developed based on our environment and what we've seen growing up. Some people think that some stuff's evil, some stuff isn't. But without the word, there is no God, there's no standard. And eventually, the road, the wisdom of man that leads to death will take over if you don't have the word and also the Lord over your life. Because you need both. You need the rule book so that you can follow the rules, but you don't need the legalistic only the word. You actually have to live it. It's your life. And that would be the way of life. I mean, I have a few scriptures here that I wanted, even, I'll just put them on the board because it's fun. There's a couple. Let's say Proverbs. Is it 12:18? 12:28. Proverbs 12:28 says, "In the way of righteousness there is life, and along that path there's immortality." Righteousness is love in action. That is the way, or the wisdom, that God wants us to follow in. I thought it was interesting in Isaiah 1:19. In 1:19, it says, "If you're willing and obedient, you will eat the good of the land." See, these are the promises. If you're willing and obedient, you'll eat the good of the land. That's the way of life. The verse right after that, it says, "But if you resist and rebel, you will be devoured by the sword," the way of death. It's written over and over again in the scriptures. I think it was Jeremiah. "Behold, I set before you the way of death and the way of life. Choose life," right? That wasn't written to the unbeliever, and that wasn't necessarily written to the unsaved. People they read that scripture sometimes and they think, "Oh, well, that's not for me. I'm saved." But if you look at it as the way of and what leads to, it means the wisdom that I, choose my way, my wisdom, and you will live. And not only that, you'll have everything you need and more. But the other way is death, and that basically means that you're pulling away from the Lordship in the fear of the Lord. And anytime you go away from the Lord, that's death. And so what I'm speaking to is not the unsaved individuals, but I'm speaking to you as a church, just like Paul did. Don't be deceived. And be careful. These four areas But I'm not also here to scare you either. I'm not saying that, we should live in fear or we're gonna be deceived and what if I am deceived, and no. God is more than enough to be able to get us through these things. And what I here's the thing. As we are, the way that we are now, and the way that what happened to Eve, it's basically written in one scripture. It's Proverbs 14:12. And it kind of sheds a light on why things happen. And it's a real simple proverb. "There is a way that seems right to a man, but in its way is death." I like it in the New Living Translation because it brings more of a responsibility to each person. It says, "There is a path before each person that seems right, but it ends in death." You're responsible for this. So let's be responsible for this. Let's look at the latter part, "but it ends in the way of death." Like I said, many Christians don't think, well, I'm not on my road to death. I'm not in my road to hell. I am saved. I'm going to heaven. So that part really doesn't pertain to me. But really, and it says it a lot in the scriptures, behold, I set before you the way of life and death, and that's Jeremiah 21:8. And that way means wisdom, like we spoke about. The way is broad that leads to destruction, those who may enter it, but the gate is small and the way is narrow, and it leads to life. That's Matthew 7:13-14. The word has to be our standard, our measure for good. Not legalism, but we need the word. It says in 2 Timothy 3:16-17, all scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach us what is true or good and to make us realize what is wrong or bad in our lives. It corrects us when we are wrong or bad and teaches us to do what is right or good. God uses it to prepare and equip his people to do every good work. Right? It doesn't say some scripture. Is that cool? All scripture is inspired by God and is useful to teach what is good and bad. We can't just pick and choose. We can't just pull out stuff that we agree with and put stuff on the shelf that we don't. And now people are going to shout legalism, but that's not the truth. Because in order for this to work, you actually have to live it. You have to make him Lord. What is Lord in your life? Lord in the Greek is Kurios, K-U-R-I-O-S. I might be saying that wrong, but I don't care. I spelled it right. K-U-R-I-O-S. It means master, owner, supreme in authority. And it means a lot more than that. I mean, you can get a page full. But just those three words sums it up. Lordship means master, owner, or supreme in authority. What is, who is master, owner, or supreme in authority over your life, your decisions, your work, your children? We don't have a right to feed from the tree of knowledge of good and evil anymore. We don't have a right. We are changed. We are individuals that have never existed before. We are a new creation, and we have no right to look at that tree and wonder what God's keeping from us. He is Lord and Master, supreme in authority over our lives and everything that we do. In Colossians 2:6-7, it says, as you have therefore received Christ Jesus as Lord, Christ Jesus the Lord, so walk ye in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith, as ye have been taught, abounding therein with thanksgiving. Beware lest any man spoil you with philosophy and vain deceit. After the tradition of men, and after the rudiments of this world, and not after Christ. Let's look at this. As ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord. It doesn't say Christ Jesus the Savior here. A lot of us come to church and we know that we're saved, but we really need to make him Lord. Why? Because it will keep us from vain deceit and philosophies and tradition of men. How does it do that? Because it gives us the wisdom to walk the correct life when he's Lord. And it gives us proper discernment so that we can judge right and wrong. properly. It's a scary scripture, and we say it here a lot in Matthew, I believe it's in Matthew 7. Not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that does the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me that day, Lord, Lord, we not prophesied in your name, or we got cast out devils, healed the sick, did wonderful works. We were passionate in the ministry, right? They had passion in the ministry. They had compassion for people. But he didn't have a relationship with them. He wasn't Lord of their life. People might have been, right? You look back at those shows and you know, what are you doing this for? Was it for your own, God forbid it was for your own self, so that you could be famous? Or that you could just feel good, or you feel needed, or you could feel wanted, or any other myriad of things that you might have, a hole that you need to fill. God forbid you did any of those things, because if he's not Lord, you're filling that gap with something else. And that's what happened to those folks. When he professes to them, I never knew you, depart from me, you work iniquity. That's a little rough. But what's really neat, I mean, I never saw this scripture before, just 2 days ago. And I thought it was so incredible. As an attitude of somebody that really has made Jesus Lord of their lives, I was looking through Habakkuk, which a lot of people don't even know that's a book in the scriptures, or how to spell it for that much, you know, matter. But it shows a perfect attitude of somebody that is Lord in their life. The opposite of somebody that doesn't have the Lord in their life is just like the Israelites. They go in circles, they compare, they compete, and they eventually, if they weren't ever, you know, caught in what they're doing, they would eventually died. But this, I thought, was great. Habakkuk 3:17. It says, though the cherry tree, this is in the Message translation, which I thought it was just great. Though the cherry trees don't blossom and the strawberries don't ripen, though the apples are worm-eaten and the wheat fields stunted, though the sheep pens are sheepless and the cattle barns are empty, I am singing joyful praise to God. I'm turning cartwheels of joy for my Savior God, counting on God's rule to prevail. I take heart and gain strength. Like a deer, I run. I feel like I'm king of the mountain. That's what happens. That's the attitude. That's the life that he wants us to live. No matter what is going on around us, which it will, because that's where we are right now. But no matter what goes on around us, when you have him as Lord and not just Savior, and you give up your stuff to follow him, take up your cross, deny yourself. I wrote down here, deny self you must, which makes me sound like Yoda. Deny self you must. Threw me off a little. But seriously, take up your cross, be responsible. Be like the Bereans and search out the scriptures when you hear the word of God. Go back. Ask the Lord. Gosh, I don't even know if that's true, God. Look it up. Study it. Do it on your own. Don't just listen to Facebook and Instagram and build that relationship. Make him Lord. What's interesting is the difference between Lord. I just wanted to hit on this a little bit. The difference between Lord and Savior. When you say Christ is the Savior, he was who saved us. That was his work. That was the work that he did. Okay? That his lordship is his position that he is. He is Lord. That's his position. His work was salvation. Right? So if we only consider his work, we don't just consider his work. We have to make his position where it should be in our lives. And James 3:17, all these 3:17 verses I love. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruit. That's his tree. We were allowed to eat from that one. Without partiality and without hypocrisy. What does Hebrews 5:14 say? It says, but solid food belongs to them that are full age, even those who have, by reason of use, exercise their senses to discern both good and evil. So not only do we need the Word of God as our standard, we need to have Him be Lord of our lives. And lordship and the fear of the Lord, which is the reverence of His position, not just His work, but His position, the honor and respect and His position in our lives over all of the other stuff, brings discernment. Why? Because the wisdom that is from above is first pure, which is what we got to be. Solid food belongs to them that are full age, even those by who reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. That statement right there in Hebrews 5:14 tells us that we don't know good from evil. We have to learn. We have to practice. In closing, I just wanted to say just in summary, those four things that the way that the enemy wants to deceive us are combated by the Word, making Him Lord, and then building proper discernment. And all three of those things it's all the teaching in this church. It's all our fundamental underlining stuff with all the modules, all the books, making Jesus Lord, not just your Savior. And, preaching the Word, making Jesus Lord, and developing full stature, right? Which is, your discernment, becoming full of age. Unlike Eve, you have surely faced disappointments, because Eve did not. She was in a perfect place. Those influences of those things that you have that you didn't deal with would be where the temptation would come in. And any unaddressed causes of doubt that God is not good, if there's anything in you that says at one point or another that God isn't good, that's where the enemy will hit. If he can make you wonder if he's withholding something from you, then he's got you. Let's just remember, that Proverbs 14:12 says that there's a way that seems right to a man. And really get this in your spirit, because the next time you think, oh, that's a good idea, make sure that it's a God idea, because I don't know how many times we've said here in church that God is love, but love is not God. Good is not God either. God is good, and every good gift comes from Him. What I'd really like you guys to do for this week even was I encourage you to just honestly assess your faith in the Lord and His goodness. And make sure that there aren't any things that are actually supreme authority over your life except for Him, which is what Lord means. I had so many notes that I had them in random order, so I hope you guys got the gist of everything. But I love you guys. I think that this is a very now word, considering everything that's been going on in politics and everything that's been going on in general. We have to know what the difference is between God's goodness and what people say is good, so that we don't follow in the same footsteps.
I'm proud of this young man.
I got the job.
And
that's when you know I'm real excited about something that the Lord's teaching me.
When he starts drawing.
When I start drawing doodles.
Because even when, I mean, he's gotten art awards from.
You wouldn't be able
to. I don't think that'll sell, but. It was so funny, though. I would try to get him to draw stuff even when he was very, very young. And he'd say, I'm not in the mood. Artists have to be in the mood. So I don't understand that part. But let's pray a closing prayer, because this is near and dear to our heart, is that I believe we can get so locked into Jesus being our Savior that we get lazy and enter into deception and disappointment. And hope doesn't disappoint. Hope stays open. And we really wish Kingdom Life people, full stature people, would memorize the seven internal thrones. Because the real test is whether he's Lord is the way God took me to the school of the Spirit and said, you've all heard teachings of the seven mountains. I'm saying, take care of the seven thrones or the seven internal mountains first. When he's Lord of those seven mountains, you're prepared for life no matter what life throws at you. And no matter what realm or jurisdiction you have in life, whether it's politics or you're a professional or stay-at-home mom, it makes no difference. Your world is to be brought the kingdom of God into that arena. But the seven thrones, when God taught me, was first of all that you're going to be spirit-led, that my spirit, that he would be Lord over my spirit, that he gave every one of us a human spirit and he wanted to be Lord over it. That's the lordship of the first and foremost, so that it's not just word, it's word and spirit. And the second thing he says is, my thoughts are higher than your thoughts. I want to be Lord of the thoughts. I want you to be so open to revelation at all times that it's not what you think. But my thoughts are higher, and I'm going to choose the higher one. That's lordship. The will, the same thing. He says, I want your will, Dennis, to be so yielded to me that it's a romance of wills. My will and your will joined together. Not some kind of religious drudgery, but a divine romance where there's an ease and a peace. And I want the peace to rule over your emotions and over your possessions. I'll never forget the time I had, it goes back a long time, but when I had my first new car, I had nothing but junks most of my life, and then I got a new car. And when I got in it, God reminded me that everything I owned, all my possessions, were him. And I drove that new car. It was the strangest impression I ever had. It was like I was driving someone else's car. Have you ever driven someone else's car? It doesn't feel the same as when you're driving your own. There is something that this is not mine. And God, I sat in that new car and I knew that it belonged to God, that everything that I owned, all my possessions, all my finances, it was under his lordship. And that was a good feeling. And so it's spirit, mind, will, emotions. Your physical body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. To start taking care of it and recognize that you are God indwelt. And the other two thrones, probably the two most difficult, even if those other ones aren't, is all relationships and all possessions. So you have spirit, mind, will, emotions, body, all relationships, the good, the bad, and the ugly, and all possessions. That includes your gifts, talents, and finances. And in this church, all of the teaching is broken down onto how effectively to apply wisdom to gain the rule of the Lord, advance the rule of the conquering king. That's what I like to say. Don't you like to say that? To advance the rule of the conquering king in those seven areas, and Jesus is Lord. I'll tell you, it'd be a lot easier to just go to church and say, I'm saved, bless God, and I'm going to go do whatever I want to do because I'm saved, I've got life insurance. But I'll tell you what, that doesn't appeal to me at all because I see there's too much danger for deception. I love Jesus, but I love my car, I love my house, I love my entertainment, I love my free time, I love my day off, I love. And a lot of times they can all be on an equal plane and you not even know that they're equal. If he's not supreme, but if he is supreme, all these things fall into place and your life becomes a beautiful tapestry of success and fulfillment in destiny. Don't you want to be a success? Because God doesn't want you living in mediocrity. The only time you live in mediocrity and don't reach your full potential is when you get deceived thinking that somehow God's holding out on you and you better, God helps those who help themselves, which is not in the Bible. All right? So, Father, we just pray that, God, you began a good work in every one of these people, and I believe Kingdom Life people are going to know that lordship of Messiah Jesus on the inside, and he's going to rule on all 7 internal thrones so that they can impact the world around them. I like it, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the peoples. I will be exalted among the nations. And I think I reversed that. But basically what it is I'm going to drop down to my spirit, be still, let go, and let God arise in my life and impact my world. That's a good paraphrase for 46:10 in Psalms. So, Father, we seal this work by this day. What you're speaking to us, God, this is the only tree we want to eat from. That's the tree of life. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
You've been listening to Pastor Dennis Clark and Dr. Jennifer Clark of Full Stature Ministries at forgive123.com. Full Stature Ministries reserve all copyright protections under applicable law. Our copyright policy is available at our website, forgive123.com. For more information about Full Stature Ministries and additional life-transforming materials, please visit forgive123.com.